keep saying that. I mean, it's very exciting. Hey, Fred, will you come back? Can you bring my cup?
I would say he probably did everything. I'd like to thank Leslie and Fred Robinson, my sister and my brother-in-law, for coming, and Fred's going to sing for us. I think you'll enjoy that. I'd like to thank Karen Goldberg Schaefer for coming, and she's going to do a prayer for us. And then I would like to especially thank Tom Seelin personally for coming and setting up the sound system, and he's going to play taps for us at the end. He's a band member from 1976. So Karen, can you come forward?
Sure.
Thank you.
Franklin has always been a community of many faces and varied faiths. In keeping with this diversity, I decided to base a short opening prayer on the words of English painter and poet David Harkins, who wrote this for the passing of the Queen Mother in 1982. We can shed tears that he is gone, or we can smile because he has lived. We can close our eyes and pray that he will come back, or we can open our eyes and see all that he has left. May we find comfort in knowing that our teacher, friend, and mentor, Irv McDowell, has been accepted into the warmth of heaven. May we find peace in keeping our eyes open to the life he led and all that he has left that still lives within us. And may all who sit on this bench feel Irv's presence and have their eyes opened to a lifelong love of learning and literature. Amen.
Little something. I hate speaking in front of adults. I'm an elementary school teacher, so adults intimidate me. Mr. McDowell was my ninth grade teacher in 1974, and I had to do the math for that, so it was a long time ago. He wore preppy clothes in a bell-bottom and hip-hugger world. His elbow patches on his sports coat, pink button-down shirts, little boats on his pants, Argyle socks and hush puppies, saddle shoes. He introduced us to Shakespeare. We read George Orwell's 1984, which seemed so futuristic at the time, and we performed the play Our Town by Thornton Wilder. Mr. McDowell had the perfect voice for the part of the narrator. It was calming and melodic. In my adult years, Mr. McDowell would come to my mind when I was able to answer one question on Jeopardy about Our Town. He was a scholar, and he had a sense of humor that didn't stop. And he could have easily been a professor at a fine university, but instead, his calling was to live life as a teacher to teenage kids, mouthy and hormonal. The quote selected for this bench is very appropriate, and it states, "A teacher affects eternity. He can never tell where his influence stops," by Henry Adams. Mr. McDowell certainly was a drop of water that rippled for over 30 years in the high school, and he will be greatly missed, but never forgotten. Thank you.
How many people know the words to the alma mater?
Two?
Good. All right, let me get a note. Got it. Memories are dear as we sing Franklin High. Enter to learn, we go forth to serve her well. Years will pass by for us, names left behind. Yet we will stay with you, pleasant thoughts in mind. For it's you that we love, for our years spent with Alma Mater, our years at dear Franklin High.
I'm Kathy, or his wife. I can't thank you enough for this. This is so very sweet and special. I know Irv loved this high school. He talked about it all the time. He was sorry Ted retired. He could have stayed here forever. But I thought, in this particular instance, I've been going through all of Irv's things over the last couple months, and I found one letter that Irv received from one of your fellow students. And I wanted to share it with you, because it's a beautiful sentiment, and I think you'd appreciate it. It's dated March 1st, 1992, and she's got excellent handwriting, too. It's amazing. Cursive. Dear Mr. McDowell, this letter is long overdue. I've wanted to write it many times since I graduated from Franklin 16 years ago, and have done so in my head more than once. It occurred to me recently that someday you're bound to leave Franklin High, and then I'll have forever lost the opportunity to write to you. I doubt you remember me out of the hundreds of students you've taught. You were my teacher for sophomore English and for a writing class I had in my junior year. This was in 1974 and 1975. You were turning 30 and making quite a big deal about it. I couldn't imagine such an age. Here I am, now 33. And she appropriately used a semicolon, by the way. What I've wanted to say is this. You were a wonderful and positive influence in my attitude toward learning, and so were a wonderful and positive influence in my life. Influence may be too strong a word. I grew up in a house full of books and newspapers and learned to love reading early on, but you introduced me to such an amazing variety of literature. Things I had never read on my own, no one would, I guess, but What Magic, Streetcar, and Macbeth, and Stopping by Woods on a Snowy Evening. We read these things and more in class, and you made them come alive, and they gave me pleasure at 15, and they give me pleasure now. Stopping by Woods on a Snowy Evening, someone recently gave my seven-year-old a wonderful book of poetry for children. We are flipping through it, stopping here and there to read a poem aloud, and lo, there was Stopping by Woods. I hadn't read it in years, perhaps since your class. I read it aloud to my daughter, and we both loved it. How clearly I remember you reading that to us, discussing the meaning of the mystery's repeated last line. This incident is what has finally prompted me to write to you. Another thing you instilled in me is a love of words and language, an appreciation of the precision and rhythm of good writing. I love to write, don't do it often. Several years ago, I started college, and it's required that every student take a basic writing course. We had to write an essay on the very first night of class, oh, something like what a college education means to me. I wrote furiously for 30 minutes, handed it in, and left. When I came to class the second night, the professor held up my essay and said, "Where is this Miss Morrow?" I raised my hand, bewildered, and she said, "May I keep this? You're exempted from taking this class." Exempted? I was stunned. She said, "Go on, you can leave. Go register for basket weaving or something. You don't need this class." I left in a daze, thinking McDowell would be proud of me. One more college story. I took a class, Writing for Business in the Professions. We had to do an extensive research paper, and we had to do it using the famous foolproof index card system that you showed us in 10th grade. I've used it several times in college, always amazed that it actually works so well. So when Professor Galbraith launched into her explanation, I nearly laughed out loud. The class was uncomprehending. I got an A. So there you have it. I've thought of you so often over the years and wanted to thank you for these gifts that you have given me. I haven't gone on to write the great American novel or brilliant poetry or biting commentary. I got married, had children, got divorced. We live in my parents' house here in Somerset, in the house I grew up in. I work for the home news and advertising sales and attends records at night. I could ramble on for several more pages, but I'll stop here. I hope it pleases you to know that you've made a difference in at least one student's life. Just, I know it was long, but I just wanted to share that with you. Say thank you again for this beautiful bench. You love it. And it would like the students sitting on it.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Dedication, and I think Andrea, you wanted to take a group shot.